Hey friends, it's Wednesday, April 29th. I want to share with you an interesting piece of medical data that came out over the weekend. A researcher analyzed 13 different studies of COVID-19 to try to answer this question, and it's a question you might have seen talked about in the media. The question is, what is the infection fatality rate for this disease? There's been lots of hypothesis and prognostication and people saying different things. This researcher said, hey, let me do the medical statistical work to analyze the data and see what we can learn. So as he analyzed these 13 different medical studies, the infection fatality rate for COVID-19, he says, is between 0.49% and 1.01%. So 0.49% to 1.01%, somewhere in that range. I've paid attention to how the medical community has responded to that, and most of the reputable scientists are saying, hey, this guy's probably right. It's within that range somewhere, okay? So that means of every 1,000 people who get COVID-19, about 8 of them may die. Just to give you some comparisons, the infection fatality rate for the flu is 0.1%, 1 in 1,000. The infection rate or the infection fatality rate for Ebola is 50%. So literally 500 out of 1,000 people die of Ebola. I just want you to have that data because it helps us understand where this disease falls in terms of its seriousness. It's certainly more deadly than the flu, not nearly as deadly as Ebola. And so, you know, we need to treat it appropriately. Obviously during flu season, you know, people don't walk around with masks on because we've sort of dealt with the fact that 1 in 1,000 of us is going to die of the flu. COVID-19 requires a little more precautions. We probably don't need to treat it like Ebola, right? Because it's not quite as deadly. So that's helpful. Here's why that's helpful to me and why I hope it is helpful to you is because we tend to respond a lot based on what the news media is feeding us and the headlines aren't very helpful. I try to pay attention to the data because the data I think is more helpful in giving a clear sense of, hey, how big a threat are we talking about and how significant a disease are we dealing with? And so this helps you know, hey, it's more significant, more deadly than the flu, not nearly as deadly as Ebola. And so that helps us understand sort of how we should process and respond to it. All right, so that's a little piece of data that was helpful to me as I read about it this week. Now, yesterday I mentioned the bell curve and I kind of teased you a little bit of like, hey, 20% of you are like, we're going to die tomorrow and 20%, like it's a fake disease and the rest of you are somewhere in the middle. I want to return to that bell curve idea because it actually is helpful for thinking about how you're going to respond and how we are going to respond to the idea of gathering again as a church. I don't know when that's going to be, by the way. You know that the governor is opening up restrictions, and so we're in active conversations about how do we want to treat the month of May. We're sort of taking it a month at a time. So how do we want to think about church in the month of May? And then the month of June will probably be different. The month of July will probably be a little different. But even as we talk about the possibility, the potential of whenever it is that we can come to the church building again for a worship service, or when your gospel community can gather again and how they can gather, here's what I want you to realize. There's 20% of you that wish that day was yesterday and you're ready to go. There's 20% of you that no matter when that day is, you're going to be slow to show up, and that's fine. And there's 60% of you that are somewhere in the middle that are kind of like, yeah, within a week or two of that date, you'll probably be excited about being together. You need to know that that spread exists, and we all need to treat the differences in that spread with respect, because anytime we're talking about gathering back together, there's going to be some of us that are really gung-ho about that, there's going to be some of us that are really reticent about that, and there's going to be a bunch of us that are somewhere in the middle. I want you to know that I understand that as a pastor, and so I realize, hey, as we move back toward the possibility of gathering again, we're going to do that whenever we can do that, and I realize there's some of you guys that are just going to be a little more hesitant to join, and that's fine. As your gospel communities begin to gather again in the month of May, begin to sort of try to spend time together in some meaningful way, even if that's sitting in lawn chairs in the driveway to sort of just be cautious. Whatever that looks like, I realize there are some of you that are just like, I don't know if I'm ready for that yet, and that's okay. And for those of you that are really aggressive and like, why aren't we having gospel community right now this week? I want you to embrace, hey, there's some people in your gospel community that are just going to be on the more cautious side, and you don't need to judge them or condemn them or think they're bad Christians for being more cautious. We need to practice and display a lot of Christ-like charity toward one another in terms of how we're going to respond to the invitation to come back together. Now, I've told you in the month of May, the simple thing we want to do is we want to restart the gathering of gospel communities. You're back to, in the month of May, permission to gather with at least 10 people. And so that means at least the women in your gospel community or the men in your gospel community can start getting together face to face. We want to sort of invite that and ask for that. And our hope is that perhaps in the month of May, if not June, we'll be able to gather again in some meaningful way to worship on Sunday mornings. And as I've said, we'll be letting you know as we make those decisions. But even as all that information comes out, I want you to understand and I want us all to embrace, hey, we're going to fall at different places in terms of our enthusiasm about that. And that's fine and good. So let's love one another well, and let's embrace the diversity that's going to be present as we think about getting back together. All right, that's today's briefing for you. Thanks for watching, and I'll have another one for you tomorrow.